Some sort of funny small windows are found on a vertical cliff in the vicinity of Bukayrent. There are tunnels behind the small windows, and although many tourists visit them every day, very few of them take a few moments to ask the question, would any human of our size invest so much labor in cutting these tunnels in the solid rock just to make something that is extremely uncomfortable to use? Look at the size of the tunnels. If you want to experience for yourself how comfortable is it to move around such tunnels, place few low tables next to each other and try propelling below them for some time. And the next exercise is to do the same while dragging sacks of potatoes, big ones. To get a first-hand experience of the version of the Quackademics, namely that these tunnels were built by people like us to store their foodstuff there. Of course, it's possible that the people who found them later on did use them for food storage, but as far as the original design having anything to do with that, I doubt this. Well, first of all, the connecting doors or holes between the chambers are so small that not all people can go through without any luggage, of course. What to speak of dragging sacks with potatoes? Is there any point to even discuss this looking at the size of the openings? Even the few bigger doors, so to say, look like that they have been widened subsequently. If somebody was carving this into the bedrock to store something, one would make big rooms. Instead of these uncomfortable tunnels, you just put few sacks and the door to the next tunnel is blocked. This is a very inefficient use of space. And again, it clearly shows that the original design was not meant especially for storing food. As you start taking your potatoes out one by one from the sacks to transport them to the next tunnel, they will all roll down to the numerous openings in the floor, which apparently facilitate the full project of food storage. Then what about hiding from the enemy? Some people have suggested that maybe that's why people used it like this. It's, of course, very uncomfortable for living, but you see, if your enemy tries to find you, their head will stick through the third floor and then you can chop off the head. Well, it's the same situation. Yes, if somebody found these tunnels, they could have used them for hiding, but as far as being originally designed for hiding, probably not, because yes, your enemy will have a great difficulty trying to crawl through these tunnels, hitting his back and head constantly, but you will be facing the very same problems, so it's useless at the end for hiding. On the top of that, if you were designing these tunnels for hiding, you wouldn't advertise yourself with all these windows clearly visible on the cliff. And by the way, the complex design of the window protections themselves show that this was probably a residence and not just temporary hiding place. First of all, look at the amount of work invested in making sure that couple of layers, sometimes reaching up to 5 or 6 layers of protections, are carefully attached to the window. Actually, the amount of work done on the details around these windows by itself suggests that these were probably even luxury dwellings. Definitely, these were premises designed for prolonged and probably permanent use. And then 6 levels of protection. That's interesting. I mean, we have usually 2. Some people would have 3 layers on their windows. But what did they have? Were they protecting themselves from some sort of animals or bad weather? And they must have had some sort of nice transparent materials. Otherwise, what's the point of putting just wooden frames? Then you may not have windows anyway, if it was non-transparent. So who built all this? Who were the original inhabitants? The first one to look out of these windows? Doesn't seem to have been a people as tall as us. In the full complex, after all, there was only one room in which we could stand properly without straining ourselves, and this room was with some sort of cuttings for storage, or maybe these were bathtubs or something like that. So the original builders were probably some other types of beings. It could have been dwarves, or let's say some sort of intelligent reptilians. Look at the holes, you can slide through them very comfortably. But I'm more inclined to believe that these were dwarves exactly after all, because if you remember the overall panorama in the beginning, we have the windows the way we have actually preserved remains of how these tunnel dwellings were ending, while we have a lot of remains of underground cities in Turkey, in Spain, in Italy, but we almost never see how do they end. It's always ruins and ruins, while here we have something unique. We can see more or less preserved windows on a cliff the way it was designed originally. So this could mean that this is a relatively recent underground dwelling compared to those of Cappadocia, Italy, and so on. And another thing that comes to my mind now is a study done by an English scientist. He studied the underground cities of Cappadocia, and he found that various races resided there. Initially, they were built by humans of our size and subsequently remodeled by a few other types of beings, and some of them were dwarves. So again, we see that dwarves come to the historic scene at a relatively later stage. And also from numerous other sources, we have good reasons to conclude that the various types of dwarves were sharing this earth in the not so far away past, even a couple of generations ago. More details about this in my video about dwarves and in the dwarfish category of the website. And exactly like in Cappadocia, in Bucarent as well, we have both underground dwellings for people of our size and underground dwellings of dwarves. But more about the various type of cities that I saw during the expedition in the next episode. And remember that finding out more about the different races who resided on our earth, shared the earth with us, is not just some curious detail. Discovering more will redefine the origin of the human species as well. And when that happens, it will change the way we perceive ourselves. And that, in its turn, will change the way we live for the better. Because knowing the truth, that means genuine knowledge, and also harmony and goodness, these are always qualities that go together hand in hand. And it is ignorance, or not knowing who we are, where do we come from, that is the brother that goes hand in hand with misery.